We are living, to quote French author Alain Minc, in un coin du paradis, in a little corner of paradise. Ladies and gentlemen, we are also living in a union of values. To this privileged situation of our continent, the work undertaken in the name of Europe by those who pursue the European dream has contributed immensely. We can be proud of that, and we should show it. Let us take a closer look. The European dream has always been about three basic aspirations: peace, prosperity, and power. This was the case back in the 50s, and it is still today. Different aspects predominate at different times. Obviously, peace was more important right after the war, and the power of a common presence in the world is a stronger motive today. But all three have been present from the start. And let me mention peace. It may surprise you. People sometimes say it is outdated to claim that Europe is about peace. Yes and no. Yes, because of course the wars between France and Germany, the horrible experience of our fathers and grandfathers against which the European community was founded, have receded into memory. But no also, because Europe is still there as a work of peace. Just 1 week ago, the Union's 27 heads of state or government paved the way for Croatia to become our 28th member state. It is a milestone. In the European Council, we also saluted the step forward which Serbia took last month with the arrest of Ratko Mladic. It was a victory for European diplomacy and for the Union's tenacity in upholding our values. Let us not forget that only 15 years ago, the countries in question were involved in a horrible civil war, only 1,500 kilometers from here and at the borders of our Union. In that respect, the entry of the Western Balkans into the Union is the last great work of peace on our continent. And I call on all of you to bear in mind the responsibility we have. Ladies and gentlemen, as long as a club attracts new members, it is in good shape. Europe is still sexy. The President of the European Council also, but the Union even more. The European dream, if the European dream were a musical piece, then prosperity would be the basso continuo. Prosperity, welfare for the citizens, has always played an essential role in the work the countries do together, sometimes under the surface, sometimes visibly. And as you know, the old European dream first came to life as a market for coal and steel back in the 50s. We are still developing the common market further every day. It is a work in progress. Business has been decisive in pushing for the single market back in the mid-80s. With the famous goal 1992. And next year, the single market will have existed for 20 years. It is one of the biggest assets of the Union. It has created welfare, jobs, and well-being in Europe. In 2009, intra-EU trade in goods represented 37% of EU GDP and in services 10% of our GDP. It has made us into the largest commercial power in the world. Bigger than the United States, bigger than China or Japan. And when we look at the EU as a whole, the economic recovery is also quite good, with forecasts of overall economic growth close to 2% in 2011-2012, only 1 year after the biggest financial crisis of the last 70 years. I noticed that in the survey, many correspondents think that slow growth is a permanent feature of our economies. Well, we are certainly not in the double-digit figures. But it's a real question whether economic growth of more than 5% can at all be sustainable in mature, not in emerging, in mature economies without population growth. I've always said that we need at least 2% of structural economic growth, and that is hard work in itself. We need that level of growth in order to safeguard our social model, even if we have to reform and adapt the model. The market has also been the secret of the Union's success in another way, tying our economies, our societies, and thus our destinies ever closer together. People live and work over the continent. We now have young people born out of a father from Finland and a mother from Malta, with a diploma from Denmark and finding a job in Frankfurt. But we can also be proud, of course, to be a Finn or a Maltese or a Dane or a German. Identity is important and diversity is an asset. At the same time, we Europeans want to develop prosperity our way. There is no sound prosperity without a sense of social justice, of fairness, of solidarity. Whether we call it the social market economy or by some other name, ladies and gentlemen, in our societies, we want welfare not only to be produced, but also to be spread. We want that solidarity is not just a word, but also a living reality. We want that everybody can participate in public life, deciding about our economic future. We have in Europe unique partnerships between employers and employees, social dialogues, and so on. Now with this way of working, now is this way of working an outdated scenario in a globalized world with multinational companies generating an annual turnover higher than the budget of a mid-sized country? Isn't the global player primarily responsible towards the shareholder so that his first glance in the morning has to be directed towards the stock markets? Or so you might ask. No, it is not so simple. Strong relationships between employers and employees are to the benefit of the economy as a whole. A positive identification with the company helps people to accept change in order to face change. It helps to accept reforms to remain competitive. It hugely increases our social stability. And in the long term, this is one of Europe's main assets. This brings me to the third aspect of the European dream after peace and prosperity, power. The 27 countries in our union are also grouping together to better defend their interests and their values in the world.